what it seemed like.
Yes, this is. You know, it's not easy finding a good theme song for a Monday show like this. Monday songs are all such downers. Yeah, there's a stormy Monday, right? But Tuesday's just as bad. There's stormy days and Mondays get you down. Monday morning blues. There's a song called It's Monday Every Day. It says, from now on, it's Monday every day because you're gone. There's a song called Manic Monday. Tuesday is better than Monday. There's no fun Mondays. We have lyrics like, I was happy this morning as I woke up in bed. Then I realized it was Monday, and I faced the day with dread. I mean, geez. In any case, I hope we can brighten up your Mondays here at Mondays with Mooch. I suppose we could do it on another night, but we'd have to find a different host, maybe Wednesdays with Wendy or something. Do we know any Wendy's? You know, the name Wendy was a made-up name just for the play, Peter Pan. It's true, it wasn't even a name before then, but I digress. Mondays with Mooch. I am Joe Muccioli, or Mooch. And these events are produced and presented by the nonprofit organization Jazz Arts Project. And our platinum presenting partner is Ocean First Bank, with support from Monmouth Arts and from you, our supporting members. So thank you, thank you, thank you. We've been doing these weekly soirees for a while now, and this is number 20. I'm proud to say we haven't yet repeated one guest. So welcome, welcome. I hope you're enjoying these events. And tonight, we have yet another very special guest who will help us discuss the music and the life of Count Basie, the kid from Red Bank. That's right. We'll also take a peek into the Institute of Jazz Studies. Vince Pelote is senior archivist and digital preservation strategist at the Institute of Jazz Studies at Rutgers University, Newark. Vince has compiled discographies on Billie Holiday, Lionel Hampton, and a discography on the Commodore Records label. He is one of the contributors to the Oxford Companion to Jazz. He has written a number of album program notes. Remember albums? Remember program notes? On Lee Konitz, Johnny Smith, Mary Lou Williams, Benny Carter, Curtis Fuller, and many others. He has written book and sound recording reviews for the ARSC Journal and Notes, the quarterly journal of the Music Library Association. He was one of the hosts of the radio program Jazz from the Archives, which aired on WBGO-FM National Public Radio. We were honored to have Vince as a speaker at one of our Talk and Jazz events a few years back, and we're happy to have him here with us again tonight. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Vince Pelote.
Welcome, Vince.
Good evening.
Hey. Hello, everybody.
Welcome, welcome, welcome. Good to see you.
Good to be here.
I miss you. I'm missing Newark now.
Oh, well. I'm in Bayonne right now. I'm in Bayonne right now.
Well, your institute is over there in Newark. I used to work at WBGO, so across the way.
Wow. Okay. Cool, man. Spent a lot of time there.
Vince, it's great to have you. We had you once before at one of our talk and jazz events. It was a kind of a lecture series we do. That I suppose this series is an outgrowth of, since we're stuck with the virtual format. We're trying to have a good time with it and welcome back, I should say.
Well, thank you. And it's nice to be back. And I mean, the last time I talked about Mary Lou Williams, so I'm with another piano player again with Count Basie.
There you go.
And, he had his own band, of course, with Mary Lou never had a big band, but she certainly was the musical director behind the Andy Kirk Orchestra for a lot of years. But,
Basie, she wrote for big bands.
Oh, yeah, she definitely wrote for big bands. Probably wrote some things for Basie, actually.
Yeah.
Because she contributed to a lot of other people's bands as well. But Basie himself was, a major figure in jazz, as most of you probably know. I think you're going to have a mixture of people on this thing here, where some of you are going to know a lot about Count Basie. People like Lawrence Schoenberg, for instance.
Lawrence here.
But then others who probably, don't know much about Basie.
Before we get into that, why don't we talk a little bit about the Institute?
Oh.
This is, an amazing institution, and you have been involved for many, many years. And I think we should first introduce that organization
right to
our folks here.
You want to play the video first? You want me to just go ahead and start talking?
We could play the video first, sure.
Yeah, play the video, get a little introduction to the video.
Melissa, do you have that?
Yes.
There it is.
When I tell people that this is the largest jazz archives in the world, they're usually shocked. They're usually surprised. I guess one reason is because it's located in an institution like Rutgers University.
We have a very comprehensive jazz collection. You have scores, you have photographs, sound recordings, correspondence. These are ways in which you can get to know someone.
This is a case that's full of the instruments of great jazz musicians. If you were to ask me to compare IJS with another major archive, it would be Cooperstown, because you have this fan base of scholars and people who, whether it's baseball or jazz, it's part of the tapestry of their life. We're listening right now to the so-called Smith-Jones recordings from 1936, and you're actually hearing his first professional recording date on this horn.
We have a lot of unique collections here that you won't find anyplace else. We have the world's largest collection of jazz journals, and these are journals from all over the world, so you don't have to go all over the world. You don't have to go to France to see a journal from France. We have it.
The difference between having books on a subject and items that document that subject is it's a very different experience to look at someone's handwriting. You know, they're writing about, being on the road and, oh, I miss you, I miss home. You can see life through those people's eyes. So it's about making a connection with the artist.
There are many things that are uniquely American, but few that have been such a major international cultural export.
It is an important music. It's America's contribution to world culture.
Food, water, sex, and jazz. I mean, it's just one of the essentials of this life.
Yeah, well, that's amazing. That's a fascinating organization over there.
Yes.
And I want to thank you for being involved and doing that, the yeoman's work there for so many years.
Hey, listen, it's not a job. It never was a job to me. It's always been a love. I've often said to people, like, jazz is my religion, and the Institute is my church. I mean, that's where I spent a lot of time. I've been there for over 40 years. Let's talk about the beginning of the Institute. It goes back to 1952. It was founded by a gentleman named Marshall Stearns, who was a professor of English, actually, at Hunter College in New York. He felt that there should be a place for people to come and study jazz, because at that time, there was no such place, really. There were no colleges or universities with jazz programs, with maybe the exception of University of North Texas, maybe. They had something going on down there, but it wasn't a place like the Institute. So he formed something in his Greenwich Village apartment called the Institute of Jazz Studies, and people could come there from all over the world, and they did, to study the music. He also wrote a book on jazz, two books actually, Story of Jazz. He wrote that as a wonderful textbook. And then the other one was a book called Jazz Dance that he wrote with his wife. And the great thing about the Institute was that it was a place you could go to where you could go and see journals from all over the world. You could see recordings, 78s primarily, but then LPs became part of the deal. And there were artifacts as well. And he realized at some point that the Institute couldn't stay in his apartment in Greenwich Village. So he sort of looked around for another home for it. And Rutgers University in Newark was the place that got it. And unfortunately, he passed away from a heart attack in 1966, probably before Rutgers was ready for it. But it did arrive at the Institute in 1967. It arrived at the library, and they put it in the basement, and it was there for a while. Then it was moved to another part of Rutgers University. Then it came back in 1994 to that library that it began in, actually. And during those times, during that time, you've had several directors of note. In 1972, Christopher White, who was a bass player with Dizzy Gillespie and others, was the first executive director. Then in 1976, in August of 76, Ed Berger, who was he just graduated from library school. He was brought in to be part-time curator, and he went on to become the Institute's associate director, longtime associate director. And he was there until 2011 when he retired finally. But he did some remarkable work there as our associate director, and wrote several wonderful books, especially on Benny Carter. That was his favorite musician probably of all time. And there's a Benny Carter Count Basie connection, actually. So we may get to that. And then in 1976, in October of that same year, Dan Morgenstern, who was a former downbeat editor. He became director of the Institute of Jazz Studies, and he was there also until about 2011. He retired. My association started in 1975 as a work study student. Then when I graduated, I came back again in 1978 to be on a grant funded program, a project for 2 years. But then after the 2 years, they kept me around. I couldn't get rid of me. And so basically I stayed, taking a 2 year grant job and turned it into a 40 year career. So that happens. I don't think it happens too often, but it happened in my case. In 2015, we got another executive director, a new executive director. His name is Wayne Winborn, who is the current director. He's been there since 2015. And it's so interesting. We've been in good hands with every one of these directors. We've been very lucky. We've had a good person step in each time, and that continues with Wayne. So we hope to continue along those lines. And I don't know what else to say about the Institute other than that it's a wonderful place to come to if you like jazz, if you want to study the music. It was never a place that was set up just for scholars and authors and people like that. It was set up for anybody who was interested in the music to come and check it out. And so it's open to everybody. We do support a Masters of Jazz History Jazz program there. So that's still going on. Of course, right now with this darn pandemic, we're unfortunately not open to the general public. We're only open to Rutgers University students. And I think at some point when we do open up to the general public, it'll probably be by appointment only. But that hasn't happened yet. Don't write it in, you know, ink. Everything changes. It could change next week. Who knows? So anyway, that's pretty much the Institute.
It is a vibrant research library. And as you say, more than that, you know, it's a repository.
It's a little bit of everything.
Of our history and our culture.
Exactly. And we can, I mean, people think of it as a library, but it's not just a library. It is a library, but it's not just a library. It's an archive, but it's not just an archive. And it's not a museum either, but we have a lot of things that would be in a museum. So it's just a lot of different things. And the reason that's the case is because for a long time, we were the only game in town. There were no other archives. There were no other places doing this. And so when people didn't know what to do with their collections, they came to us. And we pretty much accepted anything anybody gave us because there was no place else to put it. So, I mean, otherwise it would end up in the street and thrown away, and we didn't want that to happen. So we took everything. And of course, now we have other places. This is Smithsonian. There's the Library of Congress. There's Lawrence Schoenberg's place, the National Jazz Museum in Harlem. I mean, so there's all sorts of places now that take jazz, that study jazz or collect jazz. And so, therefore, we can share the wealth, thank God, and that's great to be able to do that. And that film, which is rather a few years old, because it said I was interim director, and I was from 2012 to about 2014 or so, before Wayne got there. I'm no longer interim director, of course. I'm also wearing a white shirt, which I was told was horrible. You shouldn't wear white in these films. What can I say? I didn't know any better. And the person that was doing a lot of the talking and who opened up the cabinets and showed you all the instruments and talked a little bit about Basie, that was Tad Hirshhorn, who was a longtime archivist at the Institute of Jazz Studies, who just retired this year. And I see his name.
So who was here?
He's in there. And he is one of the people responsible for the Institute being what it is today, because he helped us with collections and getting collections in. And his knowledge of jazz, encyclopedic, and also he wrote a wonderful, wonderful book on Norman Granz, jazz entrepreneur and person who's responsible for jazz at the Philharmonic. So if you don't have that book, you should try to get it. It's a wonderful book on Norman Granz.
I have to give a shout out to Tad also, because our organization, I don't know, ways back, I'm not even sure you remember this, Tad, but we did the Art of Jazz exhibit at a local art gallery, and you were instrumental in letting us borrow some of the instruments from your collection, and some photography of your own, actually, that was fantastic. So thank you.
and continuing with the Basie theme, one of the things in that cabinet that Tad opened was Lester Young's tenor saxophone. We happen to have one of them, and we've had it for a long time, for as long as I've been working there. And also last year we got the Count Basie collection that's housed now. Well, technically it's not housed at the Institute, it's in a warehouse at the moment, but when we have some space cleared up, we will bring it over to the Institute. And we were also lucky enough this year to get a Save America's Treasures grant, about $400,000, to process that very same collection. So Basie is very much a part of the Institute of Jazz Studies. And I can honestly say it's one of our major collections now, along with Mary Lou Williams and, a few others. So
that's great. I mean, yeah. You know, Basie is very much a part here,
yes,
in our little town of Red Bank, as many of you, I'm sure, know. Mm-hmm. He was from Red Bank.
Right.
I guess he was born here, lived here.
Yep, August 21st, 1904.
His father apparently was one of the founders of a church called Pilgrim Baptist Church, which is still in town, which is still here in town. So there's some history here. There's also the Count Basie Theater, now called the Count Basie Center for the Arts, And there's also the Count Basie ball field. Of course, it's up to us to keep the music going so people don't just think he was a ball player, which has happened. Because there's a Count Basie, I think it's a football field, actually. But we're very proud of him and that connection. And, you know, the more we can share about him and his music, the better, as far as we're concerned.
Well, with that in mind, you would you like to play the
let's piece? Do that.
All right, that's a piece that's devoted to or in honor of Red Bank and in honor of Count Basie. That's called The Kid from Red Bank. It's from a very famous album that his band recorded, called The Atomic Count Basie, or The Atomic Basie, or just E=MC², which is what was originally on the album cover. But anyway, let's check this out. It's a kid from Red Bank, and it features Count Basie showing you that he was more than just a one-finger pianist. There it is. Yes.
Fantastic.
Yeah, that puts a smile on my face.
You know, I've told this story before several times, but I had done a project in Bulgaria, of all places, and it was an opera project. And somewhere in a coffee shop in one of the breaks, I was just sitting there, happened to strike up a conversation with someone who sort of spoke English and, you know, heard my English and I guess wanted to practice or something. So we got into this conversation and he said, "Where are you from?" And I said, well, I figured he wouldn't know New Jersey. I said, "Well, near New York." "Well, we're near New York." "Well, New Jersey." "Where in New Jersey?" And it just went on like this, right? And finally, Red Bank. He said, "Oh, Red Bank, Count Basie." So here I am in a coffee shop in Bulgaria and they knew the kid from Red Bank. How about that?
That's great. That's fantastic. And there are probably people in Red Bank that don't know Count Basie.
Yeah. Yeah. However, I was reminded Some of our friends here in Red Bank are currently, there's an exhibit at the T. Thomas Fortune Center on Count Basie. Yeah. It showcases some of the objects from the Institute's Basie collection.
Wonderful.
I've asked them if they were able to put up a link to that exhibit or to the T. Thomas Fortune Center somehow, if people are interested in it. But there you go. That's part of a year-long exhibit that they've been working on and connected to performances and all kinds of things.
That's right. So, and I believe I sent you a link to the Grammy Foundation exhibit that they did on Count Basie called the Count Basie, the King of Swing, which some people would argue is, you didn't think Benny Goodman was the King of Swing, but you can make an argument that Count Basie was also the King of Swing. He was the real King of Swing, but anyway, we won't get into that. You know, it's funny you mentioned Red Bank and Basie, but people think that because the Kansas City connection, he's from the Midwest or from Kansas City, but he wound up in Kansas City because he was with some traveling show of some kind. It probably disbanded somewhere in the area, so he just hung out there and he joined a couple of bands that were out there. It was Walter Page's Blue Devils, and then he became the second pianist and musical sort of co-director, musical arranger of the Benny Moten Orchestra, which was a very, very well-known territory band. And I even hate calling them a territory band because territory bands are generally bands that were not in the major, major areas like New York or Chicago. These are bands that were in like places like Kansas City. But he happened to have a great contract with Victor Records and those recordings. Made his band pretty well known for a territory band. So people knew Benny Moten's band better than they knew a lot of the other territory bands. So Basie started out basically as a second pianist in that band. And he got to record some things with the band. In fact, I was going to play you something from that time, but I may hold off on that. Just to show you that, I was going to show you that Basie came out of the Stride, New York Harlem Stride tradition of piano playing. But I think the kid from Red Bank kind of gives you a good taste of that as well, that he wasn't just a one-fingered piano player. The reason why he sort of backed down from that two-fisted style, because he didn't really have to do all that. He had a wonderful rhythm section for many, many years. His original band had people like Walter Page, Joe Jones, and Freddie Green. So why do you need to kill yourself, when you have guys like that in your rhythm section? I mean, they were called the All-American Rhythm Section, and they were fantastic. They just swung their butts off, and they swung that band like you wouldn't believe. The band that you heard was actually the band that they called the New Testament Band, because the band that came out of Kansas City in 37, that band disbanded at some point, and Basie had a small septet that he was running around and playing with. And then at some point he reformed the big band, and that band stayed pretty much going until he, passed away. And in fact, it's still out there. It's under a different, person, of course, who's leading it. People call it a ghost band, I guess. But it's still out there, it's still playing, it's still performing, and it sounds great, even though it's not, the Count Basie band. It is a Basie band, and they play a lot of the charts, and it sounds fantastic. So if you get a chance to check them out, I recently heard them a couple of years ago. Was it last year? I think Alan Green and I went out there in Newark, and they were at the NJ Pack, and they played, and they sounded fantastic. They sounded really wonderful. People have any questions, by the way? I don't want to just sit here and just talk the whole time.
Well, just to clarify, we put some information up in the chat side for the local exhibit from the T. Thomas Fortune House. So there's a link there, and there's information about it, right, and how to access it if anyone else is interested.
All right. Is there any questions in the chat? I'm looking now. I don't see any questions. All right. Well, the Basie band, I did mention Benny Carter, and we did play something from that band, the kid from Red Bank. Benny Carter, who was a wonderful arranger and one of three greatest alto saxophonists to ever put the horn to lips. He had a relationship with Basie. They go way back, went way back. And Benny composed something called the Kansas City Suite. And he used Basie's band to perform this and record this, and they did for Roulette Records. And one of the pieces is a wonderful thing called Vine Street Rumble. And why don't we listen to that while hopefully you have questions you can ask or bring up while you're listening. But it shows you that Basie's band, it could interpret, you know, arrangements by other people like Vinnie Carter. And of course, going back to the early days, Eddie Durham's arrangements were very, very much a part of their band book. Don Redman contributed arrangements to their band book. And the beautiful thing about Basie is that while he might not have, you know, been the kind of arranger like a Vinnie Carter, he had a way of making sure that whatever the band played, you know, moved a certain way or sounded a certain way. If it was too busy, he would tell the band to cut that part out. And so he was an arranger in his own right, really, and a very good one, actually, because he knew how to do it. He knew if it was too much for the band. He knew if it was too crazy or too cluttered or whatever. So, you know, he always kept in mind the fact that his band, well, he always said it himself, that he saw his band as a dance band. And so he wanted to make sure that there was always that danceable beat and that, you know, the jazz was always very much a part of what was going on. So let's check out this Vine Street Rumble, Count Basie's orchestra. This is from 1960, I believe. Very low.
Can't hear it, Melissa.
Sorry, it wasn't.
That's good. We'll be right back. Yeah, swinging.
Yeah, so we had tributes to both Red Bank and Kansas City.
There you go. And Vince, I think Bill May is here in the audience, and he has a question for you.
Right.
Can you talk more about the evolution of the Basie band after Count's passing? Who have the band leaders been, etc.? Also, can you talk more about the Basie-Sinatra connection?
Interesting.
Covers a lot.
Yeah, that's a lot. And I'm going to have to plead ignorance on some of this because, quite frankly, I don't remember everybody who's taken it, who had that band after Basie passed. It had several people who stepped in. I'm afraid I concentrated so much more on the earlier part of the band or the early years of the band that my knowledge of those people who took it after Basie's passing is not something I can really speak about, unfortunately. The person that has it right now, it's on the tip of my tongue. If somebody can remember his name, you throw it up in the chat. But I just recently saw him in another Zoom thing. But for some reason, senior moment.
Andy, saxophonist and arranger Andy Farber is here as well, and he's got four of them right there. Larry Jones.
I'm looking at them too. Yeah, he's right. Yeah. Those are all good people. And Scotty's got it now.
Frank Foster, Bill Hughes, and Scotty has it now. Yeah, Scotty Bernhardt.
Yeah. All right. Great. And Frank Foster actually was on that last thing you just heard.
It was also. The guitar player.
That's right. There was a guitar player who had it for a minute.
Oh, shit. You know, my good friend, what's his name? I used to be I used to be friends with this guy.
Yeah, we're both having senior moments here.
Uh-huh. Anyway.
And what was the other part of the question? You wanted to know?
Let me find it. More about the Basie-Sinatra connection.
Oh, the Basie-Sinatra connection. Well, Sinatra loved the band. I mean, he thought it was a hell of a band, and he wanted to record with it, and he did do that, and they also performed live. Generally, Quincy Jones, I believe, took over direction of the band.
Right.
For those sessions, and... yeah, I mean, it was a wonderful match. I mean, they actually it worked out well. Sinatra wasn't like Jimmy Rushing, who was Basie's longtime vocalist in the beginning, and he certainly wasn't like Joe Williams. He had his own style, but it all worked out. I mean, I think those are marvelous recordings, actually, Basie and Sinatra. You can't ask for two better, combinations.
Got it. I just remembered it.
Okay.
Kenny Burrell.
Really?
Kenny Burrell led the Basie band, yes. Really? I went down to see him because I was friends with Kenny at the time. Yeah. And I went down to the Blue Note to see them.
Wow. Okay.
And it was kind of strange because it was Kenny Burrell fronting the band with a guitar, playing Ellington Charts in front of the Basie band. It was like a weird combination. But they did that on a tour or something.
That is strange.
It was a little strange, and I told him it was a little strange too at the time.
I mean, I guess I could slap myself on the hand for not knowing some of that stuff, but to me, the Basie band, without Basie, it's still the band, but Basie was so much a part of it, and not having him there, kind of takes, for me, this is just me speaking, all right? Maybe I'm not saying this is true for everybody, but for me, it takes something away from the band, not having him there. It's like the Ellington Orchestra without Duke Ellington in it, which, of course, happened, Mercer.
Right.
But Basie's personality, while he wasn't as flamboyant as a Duke Ellington, let's say, he put his stamp on that band in a way that was subtle, but it was definitely there. And not being there, it makes it sound a little different. It's not quite, the Basie band as far as I'm concerned, but that's me. But keeping in line with that. I want to go back in time a little bit to 1938, because I have played so far the New Testament band. I can't let you guys get away without hearing something from the Old Testament band. This is from the Bill Savory collection, something that Warren Schoenberg was very much involved with. Bill Savory was a wonderful audio engineer, audio technician. He recorded, he had a transcription thing going where he would take things, feeds from live events, Carnegie Hall, et cetera, and he would record them on discs and play them back for the musicians when they wanted to hear them. And he had a whole bunch of these discs, and when he passed away, those discs wound up at the Jazz Museum in Harlem, and Lorne, along with Mosaic Records and Scott Wenzel, put this stuff out on Mosaic Records, and some of this stuff is absolutely wonderful. And for the Basie stuff, it captures the band better than any recording that Decca Records did, because he recorded for Decca, he recorded for Columbia. And as good as those records are, there's something about hearing that band live that the records just don't get. For one thing, the band's able to play longer than they do on a 3-minute record. And they're just loosey-goosey. And I was listening to the Savory stuff when I was in my doctor's office once, and my feet were moving, like just were moving, because I couldn't, the beat was just so good. People thought I was crazy. I thought I was having a fit or something. I couldn't stop my feet from moving, because man, that stuff was cooking. And I want to play you something from that collection, A Honeysuckle Rose. It was from the famous Door, 1938. And unfortunately, I don't think there's any video with it. It's just music. So you have to look at our mugs while you're listening to it. But if you haven't heard this stuff, you know, you got to, you get your hands on this set, get it for the Basie stuff, if nothing else. The other stuff is great too, but
oh, this is the one I have, right?
Yeah. You got that. Okay. In the box, in that box thing.
Yep. Stand by.
Honeysuckle Rose, and it features Lester Young and the other tenor saxophonist, Herschel Evans. And you know, they're great. What a 1-2 punch! Wonderful. You get the two of them on this thing together. And it's different than the recorded version. This is completely different than the recorded version of Honeysuckle Rose.
Let me know if this is working.
All right. Aunt really got one really waiting for us. He's got piano up on all fours, you can see, and we're going to ride high and wide and handsome with Honeysuckle Rose.
Thank you.
Yeah. You could dance to that.
The ripping band, baby. That's ripping the band help.
Yeah, exactly. Hey, you think that trumpet player, was that Buck Clayton by any chance?
Yeah, I think it was. Man, every time I hear that, I just go, wow.
I know.
You heard both of them. You heard Lester in the beginning, and Herschel took it in the end. I mean, it's... can you imagine a band with those two guys in it every night listening to that? I mean, it must have been fantastic, man, to be a part of that. I mean, it's great stuff.
We did have somebody asking about the singers in the early years also.
Well, Billie Holiday was... Well, Jimmy Rushing was the male singer, the boy singer, as they used to call him those days. And Billie Holiday was the girl singer, as they used to call it those days. And then I guess the other famous name, Helen Humes, who took over, and he had other singers in the band. Of course, in the New Testament band, Joe Williams was the main singer.
We have this picture we talked about earlier. Yeah. Neither of us could identify this one. Maybe somebody here can.
Yeah, maybe somebody else.
Why don't I share that and see if anybody can identify this singer. Is this the one? Yeah. Sitting down next to Basie.
Yeah, I don't know who that... That's not Helen Humes, I can tell you.
Anybody?
Lauren?
Andy? Lauren? No, huh? You can unmute yourself to talk if you want. I guess not. Okay, time's up.
Yeah. I'll have to do some research on that one.
Right.
And Billie Holiday, while she was with the band, she unfortunately never got a chance to record with the band, but there are some air shots where she is singing with the band. And they're marvelous. She was a marvelous singer, even with big bands as well as small groups. And of course, Rushing was just great. I think you just can't get any better than that. Also, the alto saxophone player, Earl Warren, he would take some of the vocals as well. He did some singing in the band as well. And of course, there were guest singers. There's a crazy thing with King Joe with Paul Robeson, which is very weird if you ever heard that, to hear Paul Robeson trying to sing the blues.
I can imagine, yeah.
Marvelous singer as he was, he was not a blues singer. I'm sorry.
Right. going back to after Basie, a time with the band, I did a thing with Frank when Frank Foster had the band. Mm-hmm. And it was some sort of a demonstration for how to put a chart together, essentially, how to put a recording, in fact, together. And in the space of 1 hour, Frank Foster wrote a tune, wrote an arrangement, somebody gave him the lyrics or something, they played it down with the band in the course of an hour. And I was there as his copyist. Wow. So he would write a page of score in pen and ink.
Wow.
One page at a time. Tear it off and hand it to me, and I'd start scribbling out all the parts, and he was like staying ahead of me writing the whole score, and I was trying to scramble with the parts. We finally got all the parts together, passed it out to the band, and it was like the first take was a take. It was an incredible experience.
Yeah, I think we have one of his arrangements at the Institute of a re-recording of a rearrangement of Broadway, and it's weird because he actually has each part has the name of the musician on it instead of the first trumpet, second. It actually had the musician's name. So I thought that was kind of interesting. I'd never really seen that before.
Yeah, Duke did that from time to time also.
Did that also? Okay.
Oh yeah, a lot. Some and Gil Evans even also. I mean, they were writing for their band, for specific people that they had in mind.
Yeah.
So yeah, it's definitely interesting. I just need to take a break here and do a little commercial announcement with Carmen. Are you around and available? Carmen Ballantine is our development director. And I caught him sleeping, I bet. Oh, there he is.
I'm actually here. Good evening, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us tonight. And I think we have a lot of new faces here. So you may have heard of us if you've not been to visit us out in Red Bank and seen us. Jazz Arts Academy has been around for 15 years, and we're a nonprofit organization that works to support the legacy of jazz by jazz education with our students through the Jazz Arts Academy. And I'm going to try something new. I was actually trying to set up a screen share, since that's something new for me. Let's see. Can I do that? Can I do that? Let me try that screen share. Here we go. So we have, I'm going to try it my first time here. So this, don't be too nervous. It's just going to take you to our website. Can you see that? I hope you can see that. We had our summer music camp, which was for our middle school students this year. We did that online. So we had a whole, was it an 8-week program, Joe?
6 weeks.
6-week program, teaching the students music, middle school students music online, how to play instruments and learn about music theory and things like that. We also have our Jazz Arts Academy. I want to find that one second. I got to click over here. Excuse me. I can't get to my tabs because I can't see from the screen here. Sorry about that. There it is. We also have the Summer Jazz Cafe. I'm going to show you the Summer Jazz Cafe. Typically, when we're not in COVID, we're getting together listening to music. And we do that in Red Bank at Two River Theater. That's another one of our great events. And you can see some of the pictures here that we've had in the past. And we're looking forward to doing that again. And then last but not least, if I can get to that one, this is the Jazz Arts Academy, which is our music education program for high school students. And you can see the students here playing their instruments. And so the Jazz Arts Academy is in production. We are teaching classes, and we're going to be doing those things remotely as well. So we can't do those things without support. So we love to have your support. You can visit our website. I'm going to put that up. I can't do that at the same time.
I just put it up.
Oh, you put it up. Thank you. You can visit our website at www.jazzartsproject.org. And you put a little slash after that, hit donate. You can make a contribution to our organization. So thank you so much. Thank you, Vincent, for being here tonight. This has been wonderful. Really enjoy it. And give it back to you, Joe.
Thank you, Carmen. That was fantastic.
That was my first time trying to.
Screen share.
Oh. Yeah, my first screen share. So it was a little rocky.
You did great.
I'm good, yeah. By the way, though, Lauren Schoenberg thinks that singer's name was Bixie Crawford, which is possible.
Okay, so, interesting.
Yeah.
Thanks, Lauren.
Yeah, Lauren. And thanks for the savory stuff, too.
You're very welcome.
Wow, we have a font of information in this room tonight.
Yes, we do. Do I have time to play one last thing, maybe, or three?
Yeah, let's do that. Sure, absolutely. Okay. And if anybody has last minute questions, let's get them in quickly.
Yeah.
While this is being played.
Right. We've done everything except seen a video of Count Basie. So I picked out something that shows him with Oscar Peterson. Now you couldn't think of two quite different piano players than Oscar Peterson and Count Basie, but you know what? It works.
This is a great video. This is
it
great.
It really works. Peterson had a lot of respect for Basie, and likewise, of course. And, you know, Basie proves that you don't have to throw pyrotechnics and the kitchen sink out there in order to make a statement, a musical statement. They complement each other quite well. And this is something called Jumpin' at the Woodside. Let's check it out.
You got it.
I know it. It's right in here, too.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Right.
Great that question. Was, it must have been in England somewhere. It was for the film for the BBC.
What year was that?
It had to be, I would probably say it was probably late 70s, you know, maybe the early 80s.
Okay, let's see. See question, let's see. I have a question for Vinny. Vinny? Who is a fine guitar player? Oh, Vinny, I saw that somewhere. You're a guitar player. I saw actual evidence of that on one of the pictures.
Yeah, I play at it, yes.
Can you talk a little bit about Freddie Green?
Yeah, I wish I could play like Freddie Green.
There you go.
Freddie Green was not the original guitarist in the Count Basie Orchestra. That's something that I had to correct somebody on, who should have known better. The original guitarist was Claude Fiddler Williams in that band.
Say it again?
Claude Fiddler Williams. When they left the city and came east, he was the guitarist and he played violin also.
Right.
And what happened was Hammond didn't like him. So John Hammond, who was very much involved in Basie's business, even that early, convinced him to get rid of Fiddler Williams and put in Freddie Green, who he liked. He saw him playing in a club somewhere in New York, and that's how Green got into the band. But I can't complain, because to be honest with you, Freddie Green has been a very, very important cog in that rhythm section. And again, you know, I mean, this is blasphemous to say this and everything, but you know, without Freddie Green being in there doing his thing and chalking away in that rhythm section, again, it doesn't quite sound like Basie. You know what I'm saying? He was so much part of the Basie sound, and he pretty much. I mean, there are a lot of ways to play rhythm guitar, but his way has sort of become the standard. You know, that's how you're supposed to play rhythm guitar, like Freddie Green plays it. Even though there were other guys that played rhythm guitar as well and played it quite, you know, so differently. But Green's style was just wonderful, you know, using a lot of inner voicings and staying away from the higher strings and just, you know, moving. I mean, I could sit here and be very technical about all this, but I'll lose everybody. But his sound and what he was able to do with an acoustic guitar. He wasn't playing an electric guitar. He was playing an acoustic instrument, very high action, and he wasn't had iron fingers in order to get the kind of volume that he was able to get using an acoustic guitar and a rhythm section like that. And you could hear him. I mean, you honestly could hear him.
He became the standard bearer for rhythm guitar ever since.
A friend of mine, he was in a group called the Swing Reunion that was going around, a small group with Remo Palmier played the electric guitar and Green was playing the acoustic guitar. And I asked Remo, you know, did you look at the instrument? I mean, was anything special about it? He said, yeah, the strings were so high off the neck and the tension was so much. He said that the neck was actually bent. Somehow he got sound out of this thing. I mean, like Remo couldn't play it probably because he was used to the electric guitar with a easier action. But yeah.
Andy Farber says they were bronze strings also. They're louder than steel.
And they probably were like, you know, very thick and just to get that sound. That's how you got to do it. You can't get that sound any other way. You can't get that any other way.
That rhythm section was unbelievable, and he made it. Yeah,
he made it. He was a big, big.
There is a story out there where he discovered like an amplifier at some point, and he had this. It was like an old tube amp, and he got into this. He thought it would be better for him. He could hear it better or something, and so everybody in the band just hated it. They just hated the sound, and it never swung right. It was horrible. So the guys in the band used to go by his amp and like steal a tube once in a while, until it ended up just to be a shell, just like a box shell. And finally, he gave it up and went back to the acoustic.
Never heard that story. That's great. That's great. And it just sounds different. I mean, you know, electric guitar playing rhythm. You know, the only person I ever heard who could do that that sounded any good was Bucky Cicciarelli. You know, it doesn't sound right when you do electric guitar. That sound, man. It's just something about it.
Well, Vince, you know, this has been fantastic. We learned a lot. We had a great time visiting with you and hearing about the Institute, and you know, and with hopes that we can all get back there in person sometime soon. but thanks so much. Thank you to everyone who came by. Thanks to Ocean First, our platinum presenting partner. And Jacqueline, Melissa, and Carmen, thank you for your help and technical expertise on these things. So if everybody can, you can unmute yourselves and we'll all give Vince a round of applause. Here you go.
Thank you.
Bravo.
Thank you.
Bravo.
I heard that.
I can.
For next time.
Next week is going to be Andy Farber, who was in here just a minute ago. I don't know where he went. He probably ducked out. But
I'm here. I'm sitting around.
Where are you?
I'm cleaning my kitchen. I just had to stop to applaud. Otherwise, I'm emptying the dishwasher.
Oh, there you are. So Andy Farber is going to be our guest next week. Alto saxophonist, arranger, composer, and bon vivant, as they say.
Thank you, Andy, for your contribution.
So, thanks, folks. And we're going to pull the plug, I suppose. But, Vince, thank you.
Thank you, Joe. Thank you.
We will be in touch.
Appreciate it. Thank you.